us here on Wednesday night for prayers
of the past that had been attacking the people of God. And as we continue to pray, we started breaking down those generational patterns. We started licensing against and bringing confusion over those generational curses. And I felt the Lord speaking in my heart that today I should be able to come and speak to you about breaking generational and family curses. Amen? So I want you to be attentive. I want you to just bear with me for the next few minutes so that you can hear what the Lord has in store for us. Amen? And our theme is from book of Galatians chapter number 3 and verse number 14. Galatians chapter number 3 and verse number 14. Hallelujah. That's going to be our theme today for our message. And in the title of the message is Breaking Generational and Family Curses. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Amen. The Bible says in Galatians 3 and verse number 14 that the blessings of Abraham might come upon the Gentiles in Christ Jesus, that we might receive the promise of the Spirit through faith. Let's go verse number 15. Hallelujah. And verse number 15 says, thank you, Jesus. Thank you. Brethren, I speak in the manner of the man, though it is only in the man's confinement, yet it is confirmed that no one annuls or adds to it. Amen. Praise the Lord. I just want to speak in those two verses today, but the main thing is about generational and family curses, and then you're going to see how I'm going to connect that with that. Amen. So when you talk about generational or family curses, what are they? Those are negative patterns or occurrences that are noticeable within particular family or communities. I'm going to repeat again. Those are negative patterns or occurrences that are noticeable within particular families or communities. For example, where a family where people die before a certain age, or where marriages are being challenged. Some people, you find some families that your mom, your grandmother divorced, and then your mom got married and she got divorced, and then you got married and you did not keep your marriage. So it's like a negative pattern that comes from generation to generation to generation. Or you have seen some people where you see, my great-grandfather was a drunkard, and then my grandfather started drinking heavily, and then my father fell into the same trap where he started drinking, and now here I am suffering also with the drunkenness, and then my children are also drinking. So it's a negative pattern that comes from one generation to another generation, and it's passed through generation through bloodline. Or you find a situation where you have a family where, you know, like your great grandmother was, you know, died through hypertension or through cancer, and then your grandfather died through the same disease, and then your father was also died also through the same disease. And then you go to the hospital and you are diagnosed with the same disease. So it's a negative pattern or occurrences that are noticeable within particular families or within particular communities. Or also maybe your community is so believed that your community, every person in the community has anger issues, because your community is associated with that. And we embrace it and we move with it. We have some families where they have like negative death and strategy and tragedies. We have miscarriages and unnecessary death that happens within a certain community or a certain family. We have some families have that kind of hatred that is moved from one generation to another generation. Maybe through land issues, through investment issues, where you have a case where your great grandfathers were fighting over a certain business or a certain piece of land. And that was not enough. It was passed to your great grandfather. And your great grandfather passed the same keys to your grandfather. And your grandfather passed it to your father. And your father passed it to you. And you're still fighting over the same demon that was moved from generation to generation. Wow. Am I relating with somebody?
Yes.
There are some satanic hatred that are moved from generation to generation. That tells me that these are passed through the bloodline. And those things happen. We have some people where they are choking and destinies are aborted even before they mature. You hear some people say that nobody ever graduated in high school in my family. My great grandfather did not go through college. My grandfather did not go through college. My dad did not go through college. And here I am. I'm just about to drop out. And I have a justification because nobody ever graduated in my family. Somebody says that in my family, nobody has ever gone through the aisle to get money. Because my great father disappeared when she went to fetch water and she found my grandmother and they went home. And then my grandfather, the same thing, she went out for a crab and they disappeared and they got married. And then he said, my mom went out there to another land and she got somebody and she don't know how she got married. And here I am in the land of America and I'm just about to sneak into somebody and live with them. Am I speaking to somebody? This is a pattern. This is a negative pattern of occurrence of things that are flowing from generation to generation. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Those are negative bloodline transfer. And it possibly happened because there was ancestral or illegal or disastrous transaction that happened between your family and an enemy. Praise the Lord. They call me witchcraft. Some illegal transaction that happened. And yet, it has been passed from generation to generation to generation, and we have all believed in it. And some people are so proud of it. Some people say that my family, we are people who are, we all drink in our family. It runs in our family. And we accept it, and we are so happy with it. And some people say that our family, we are all angry in our family. We are easily angry. We don't joke around. We are people. We are angry every time. And we all believe it. Praise the Lord. And you see today, even the medical experts, they acknowledge that fact because when you go to the hospital, the first thing the doctor asks you, they say, in your family, do you have somebody who have a history of hypertension? They ask you, do you have somebody who have a history of cancer? They acknowledge it and they say that if you have somebody who have that history, possibility is you also have to have it. So the experts believe in it. They acknowledge it because it's an occurrence, it's a pattern that moves from generation to generation. Praise the Lord. So curses are those limiting forces that keep God's people in one level. Those limiting forces that keep you in the same level. That when you talk about to move to another level, the same force come and bring you back to another level. They are disempowering. They disempower you. They take away from your potential. That you do not maximize your potential. Am I ministering to somebody today? Is there somebody that is relating what I'm talking about here today? The Bible says in the book of Zechariah, chapter number 1, and verse number 19 and 21, that there were forces, there were four horns that were scattered in the whole land of Judah. And those four horns that were scattered there, they kept Judah. Judah from Lysinger. And the Bible says that God, through Zechariah, he saw a vision where God sent his angel. And the angel of the Lord came and they sent the carpenters to come and destroy and break down and scatter those horns of Gentiles.
Praise the Lord.
Are there some horns that are holding you that whenever you want to rise up, they keep you putting you down? Today, in the name of Jesus, every power that limits your family, every power that limits your dream, every power that limits your destiny, every forces that limit you to from getting to your full potential, it will be broken in Jesus' mighty name. And somebody shout hallelujah! Praise the Lord. You have the power to break. You have the power to reverse every negative curse that is in your family, that is in your bloodline. Praise the Lord. Look at your neighbor and tell your neighbor you have the power.
You have the power, neighbor,
to break it. You have the power to reverse it. In Jesus' mighty name. Somebody give God praise all over this house. I want to give you a few examples in the Bible before I tell you how we're going to break those forces. Amen? Yeah. Example number one of somebody that was going through a generational crisis is Abraham himself. And you all know Abraham as a man of faith. You all know Abraham as a man that was called by God to move from his land to the land that God was showing. But let me tell you, even as much as Abraham had been called by God, when he was told to move from the cover, from the negative environment, from the forces that were limiting him, there was still something that was in the bloodline. Amen? There was something that was in the bloodline. First number one, we find that Abraham, his wife Sarah was barren. She could not bear children until God intervened. And the same thing was passed from Abraham to his son Isaac, where his wife Rebecca was also barren, could not bear children until God intervened. And the same thing was passed from Jacob. It was passed to Isaac, passing to his son Jacob, where the wife Leah was also barren until God intervened. What was the possibility of Abraham to have a wife that could not bear children and then pass it on to his son Isaac, go and pick up a woman that could not bear children? And the same thing in the same generation, the third generation. What was the possibility? Praise the Lord. That's number one thing that they had is a family. Number two thing that had also in the family of Abraham was the fact that there was a spirit of firstborn denial. Praise the Lord. And we find that in Abraham, his firstborn son, who was who? Huh?
Isaac.
Who was the firstborn son?
Isaac.
Who was the firstborn son?
No.
Ishmael. Ishmael was the firstborn son of Isaac, and his birthright was denied by Isaac. Praise the Lord.
Every eye open in this house.
Yes,
Ishmael was the firstborn, but the son, the fact that Isaac came and took off the birthright where Ishmael was sent out. And it also happened that Isaac, his son Jacob, and Saul took the birthright from his brother. Praise the Lord. He took it up from his brother. And it also happened that Jacob, who was the third generation, Reuben, who was supposed to be the firstborn, was also taking the birthright. And this one was so crucial that it went up to the 11th generation, where Joseph became the higher or the firstborn life was taken by Joseph. It deteriorated from one generation to another generation to another generation. Praise the Lord. What happened?
Jacob realized that this one, I'm not going to pass it on to my next generation. It took the realization of Jacob, where he wrestled with the angel of the Lord for the entire night. He wrestled with the angel for the night. And the Bible says in the morning, he was broken. Received, the joint was dislocated. And when the joint was dislocated, something was dislocated in the bloodline. And he was asked, what do you want, me to do for me? He said, I'm not going to leave you until you bless me. And the Bible says that from that moment henceforth, his name was changed from Jacob to Israel. And from that time, nothing else was passed through the bloodline. Praise the Lord. If there's somebody in this church today that is standing like Jacob and saying that I'm going to wrestle with the angel of the Lord, I am going to wrestle with God until he blesses me. Praise the Lord. It was crucial in those three generations. You got also to remember that the same generation, they also struggled with things to acquire things. Abraham struggled with the people of Sodom. Isaac wrestled because of the wealth of his father. And also Jacob wrestled, willing to get his wages and salary. The struggle was continuing from generation. But it took Jacob to stand in the gap and break the curse. Amen? Amen. That is one example in the Bible. Another example I want to give you is in the New Testament. I'm just going to give you two so that you can move on and break those curses in Jesus' name. The Bible says in the book of Luke, chapter number 7, and verse number 7 to 15, that there's a widow of the city of Nain, and she was a mother. She was widow, that means the husband had died. And now she was on her way to bury her only son that was left. Do you see some negative pattern that was moving? She was a widow, the father had died, and now the son that was only left, she was on her way to bury. And the Bible says that the master of the universe, Jesus himself, encountered with this woman when she was just about to go and bury her only son. And the Bible says that Jesus, when the procession was going on, when the coffin was passing by, when everybody was crying, that Jesus came and intervened and touched the coffin and told that young man to get out of that coffin in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. Hallelujah. He intervened the procession. He broke the power of death. He broke the power of curse in Jesus' mighty name. I declare today that whatever power that has been canceled has been put in your family, that Jesus will help somebody to cancel it in Jesus' mighty name. Hallelujah. Take 10 minutes to break and give God praise all over this house. Woo! Come on, somebody. Give God praise. Give him praise. He deserves it. Hallelujah. So how can we break those negative patterns? How can we break them? Are they meant to destroy us? Or are they meant, do we have power over them? How do we break those forces, somebody? As Christians, because we realize that those things are forces from the past, God has raised you for this generation so that you can rise above them. And the way you can break those forces, number one, you break them through the blood of Jesus. Amen. And that's where Galatians 3:13 comes, that it is through the blood of Jesus that gives us a new bloodline. You may have come from the bloodline of witchcraft. You may have come from the bloodline of thieves. You may have come from the bloodline of drug dealers. You may have come from the bloodline of the people who do not go to school. But in the name of Jesus, when the blood of Jesus is infused in you, it has the power to change and to transfer whatever bloodline you've come from, in Jesus' mighty name. Hallelujah. Somebody shouts, blood of Jesus. There's power in the blood of Jesus, and the blood of Jesus has the power. That's why the Bible says that when Jesus himself was crucified, and his blood shed and were drawn on the floor, the Bible says that the ground shook, and it reversed every power and every forces and every curse that was there in the past.
That's true.
That's why when you embrace the blood of Jesus, there's power in the blood of Jesus. That's why Jesus, when I spoke about the Holy Communion today, when you take the Holy Communion and you take the blood, you are reversing every forces. You are reversing every curse. That's why it's called the cup of the blessings. Amen? There's power in the blood of Jesus. Bible says in the book of 1 Peter chapter 1 and verse number 18, that you are not born with corruptible things, silver and gold, but the price that was paid for you is so precious because you are bought by the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. And there's power in the blood. Number two, something that will break the force, is the revelation of the truth through the word of God.
Amen.
The revelation of the truth through the word of God, where you discover what the Lord says about you, where you discover what the word of God says about classes, where you discover your position in the kingdom of God, where you discover who you are. Because if you do not discover who you are, any avenue will take you where you want to go. But when you discover who you are through the word of God, it's going to help you change the way you do things. Last Sunday I told you that when you came to this world, you came to this world looking like your parents. But you leave this world looking like your choices. Praise the Lord. So that means the choices that you make through the word of God is the choices that are going to help you live fast things that are happening in your life in Jesus' mighty name. Hallelujah. Number three, you break family and generational curses by the channel of prayers and fasting. The channel of prayers and fasting. The Bible says in Matthew chapter number 17 and verse number 21, that some of these demons do not just go only by prayers, but they require fasting. You got to pray, you got to fast, so that you can be able to break those generational and family curses. Amen.
Amen.
Look at your neighbor and say prayers.
Prayers.
Fasting.
Fasting.
Can I say it again? Say prayers.
Prayers.
Fasting.
Fasting.
Can I say fasting again? Prayers.
Prayers.
Fasting.
Fasting.
Yeah. Can't be eating from January until December. Hamburgers. Even and everything. And yet you want some forces to be broken in your life. You've got to do sacrifice. I tell your neighbor, you've got to do some sacrifice. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
This power, even Jesus himself fasted, and he was a son of God. What makes you think that you cannot fast? What makes you eat from January until December? January fast until December 31st without giving yourself a break. You got to take time. Fast, seek God, and seek the way of God. Because when you seek God, you are drawing yourself close to God. Amen?
Amen.
You are drawing yourself close to God. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Number four, the way you break them is the power of blessing that comes with the honor. Blessings reverses every curse. Amen? The power of blessings. How do we receive the blessings? Number one, as children of God, we got to embrace that there are blessings that come from this altar. There are blessings that come from the altar, from the servants of God, There are blessings that comes from pastors. There are blessings that comes from the men in the authority. And if you honor, blessings comes on your way. If you dishonor, blessings do not come on your way. Praise the Lord. That's why the Bible says that the only promise that comes with something attached to it is the promise that is the commandment, is the one that comes with the promise with it, is the blessings of honor. Honor your father and your mother so that you can have long life. Praise the Lord. That's the power of blessings. As a children of God, you got to learn how to honor. You got to learn how to honor. So many people have limited their potential because of dishonor. So many people have died prematurely because of dishonor. So many people have failed to live to their target because of dishonor. And I pray today, as you learn how to honor, there's a power of blessing that comes with honor, and that reverses every curse that has been set over your life. Amen? Amen. Maybe your parents have told you that you are never going to get married. But once you honor the anointing that is in the house of God, when I speak a blessing and the first half of that I say that you're going to receive marriage in Jesus' mighty name, that blessing reverses the curses in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Can somebody give God praise over this house? Hallelujah. Number five is a prophetic mantle and the power of declaration. Prophetic mantle. Prophetic mantle is the prophet, is the voice of the prophet when the Lord speaks through his prophets. When the Lord speaks through his servants. And when you have that mantle in the house, it breaks every curse. It changes the order of things. It doesn't matter how the pattern was. But it got to the point where Jacob, after wrestling with the angel of the Lord for the whole night, there was a prophetic declaration that was made that his name changed from Jacob to Israel. I declare in the mighty name of Jesus that somebody's name will be changed from Jacob to Israel in Jesus' mighty name.
Amen.
That when your name changes, everything falls with the blessing that comes with the change of your name. Some people have been operating with their own names for years and years. But I pray that today in the spirit, that somebody's name will be changed in Jesus' mighty name.
Amen.
Is there somebody that wants God to change their name today?
Amen.
Just pray that God himself will change your name in Jesus' name. And when your name is changed, things will change in your life.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Another way to break those forces and curses is by sacrifice, communion, and offering. Sacrifice. Sacrifice. When you offer sacrifice to God, you offer sacrifice through worship, you offer sacrifice through service to God, you offer sacrifice through helping others, you offer sacrifice through giving and helping the house of God to be in order. Amen?
Amen.
Sacrifice. And sacrifice is something that gets you out of your comfort zone. Sacrifice is something that you feel it. If you've never given until you feel it, that's not sacrifice. A sacrifice is when you come and you give a check to the house of God and you leave that house scratching your head, asking God, is that really your will, God? That's sacrifice. And even binding the devil, telling the devil, if devil, you are the one who is telling me to give all my money, I bind you in the name of Jesus. You feel like you don't know what is happening. That's sacrifice. When you give until it hurts. No amen to that.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. The next one is communion. When you have the Holy Communion, when you commune with God, and we are just about to partake that Holy Communion, and when you take the Holy Communion, you embrace the blood of Jesus and the body of Christ, and you believe it, it changes the order and the pattern of things in the DNA. Amen?
Amen.
And the other one is the offerings. The offerings, tithe and offerings. When you give the tenth of what you have in the house of God, and then you go past and you give the offerings, those are the power, those are the forces that makes people break those curses in their families. Amen?
Amen.
God wants to bless you so that you can be a blessing to many. Praise the Lord. When you talk about giving, I heard this story of a man that was trying to get to give something to the monkeys. And the monkeys, they put something, they put some treats inside a bucket in the monkey, and it was so small. So the monkeys would put their hands and hold onto that small treat that was inside the bucket. And the monkey was so hungry that they want to eat something, but they cannot let it go. What they are holding. And that man kept on instructing the monkey and telling the monkey, let it go, so that you can be able to grab the one that is on the air. But the monkey was still holding to that small one that was there and could not let it go. And the monkey was growing old and getting weary, trying to grab what was inside the bucket. And this man told the monkey, he hit the hand of the monkey to let it go. And when the monkey was hit the hand, he let it go. And all of a sudden, the monkey was able to grab the fruit that was on the tree. It's the same thing that happens in the house of God, where most of us are holding the small that we're holding in our pockets. And the Lord is telling you, let that go, so that you can see the fruit that I have for you. And most of us are still holding onto those small ones that are inside the bucket. But in the, by the grace of God, when you know the power of offering, you can be able to let it go so that you can be able to grab what God has in store for you. Praise the Lord. It's the power of offering. It is the power that comes with offering. Amen? When you do all those things, what you are doing prophetically in the spirit, you are breaking the forces. You are breaking the negative patterns that were passed from generation to generation. Amen?
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
I hear some parents say, oh, look at my son. He is so angry like his dad. And you keep empowering that. And some people say, oh, look at this one. This one who never even, they don't even, I don't even know where we should take them to school because their dad never used to get anything in school. And then you just destroy the destiny of your children by the word that you speak with your mouth. But as a Christian, you have the power to reverse the curse that came from generation to generation.
Amen.
Hallelujah. You have the power to reverse that in Jesus' mighty name. You have the power to reverse it in Jesus' mighty name. And today, we are going to do it so different. Because I want you yourself to do it and reverse it with the revelation of the word of God. Amen. In the next few minutes, we are going to have a holy communion.